months.
The Philippine peso falls to a new record low of 57.43 against the U.S. dollar.
And the World Bank sounds the alarm over a growing threat of a global recession.
Good afternoon, I'm Ron Crew.
And I'm Denise Dinsai.
You're watching Top Story. Metro Manila back to moderate risk case classification for COVID. The health department says the region's positivity rate has gone up to 16.4%. DOH officer in charge Maria Rosario Vergeri says the agency is determining whether the increase in cases can be attributed to the resumption of face-to-face classes.
Ito pong ating national capital region, if we try to look at this, disaggregating it, meron po tayong 11 out of the 17 cities and lone municipality in NCR na nasa moderate risk case classification. And meron po tayo na 6 out of the 17 na meron hong pagtaas ng mga ward accommodation or admission sa kanilang mga ospital. Although ang ICU natin sa NCR, we only have Pasig and Muntinlupa na medyo mataas ang kanilang ICU admissions. Hindi natin pwedeng i-attribute na itong pagtaas ng mga kasong ito dito sa pagtatanggal ng mask outdoors. Because as I've said, it would take us around 1 to 2 weeks for us to be able to analyze the effect of this easing of masking or optional masking outdoors. What we can say, tumaas ang mobility mula nung nag-umpisa yung face-to-face classes. So tinitignan natin yung link at relasyon nito dito sa pagtaas kasi hindi naman natin nakikita yung ganitong pagtaas sa ibang rehiyon.
Overall, the country's COVID positivity rate has risen to 12.5% as of September 13, from 12% last week. The health department now warning against complacency. This is after the World Health Organization said the end of the pandemic is in sight.
This has caught parang quite a stir sa ating mga social media platforms. Marami nagtanong. Marami kasi hindi binasa yung buong artikulo. Ang ginawa ng marami, binasa yung title, tapos akala nila siguro sinasabi na ng WHO, patapos na tayo sa pandemya. Ang sinasabi po ni Dr. Tedros doon sa article na yan ay the end of this pandemic is in sight. Ibig sabihin, nakikita niya na baka dadating na tayo doon sa punto that we can be able to declare, no? Magde-declare ng WHO ng katapusan. Pero ang pinaka-importante sa mga sinabi niya, kaya niya nakikita yan dahil sabi niya, nakikita na niya na nagde-decline na ang number of deaths, nagde-decline ang number of severe and critical across the different countries in the world.
An independent monitoring group does not see the rise in COVID cases in Metro Manila as a cause for alarm. Dr. Guido David of Octa Research notes, the hospitalization rate in the region is still at a safe level. The healthcare utilization rate in Metro Manila is now at 39%. Which, David says, is still below the 50% threshold. But he stresses the public should be aware that infections are rising.
Personal responsibility is key. So pag updated and informed yung mga kababayan natin, they will be able to act accordingly kung ano yung nakabuti para sa kanila.
Aside from Metro Manila, Octa Research says it has also seen a rise in COVID cases in the provinces of Rizal, Bulacan, and Pangasinan.
Meanwhile, 167 new cases of Omicron subvariants detected in the Philippines. The health department says most of the infections are of the Omicron BA.5. The rest are of the BA.4 and of other sublineages. The agency also reported 4 new cases of the highly transmissible Delta variant.
Turning now to the budget deliberations at the Philippine House of Representatives, lawmakers flagged the Public Works Department over its unutilized funds. House Deputy Minority Leader Bernadette Herrera D. says the funds could have been used for the agency's unfunded projects.
Meron po tayong unreleased appropriation na 39 billion and unobligated allotment na 48 billion noong 2021. At ang pinakamasakit po eh, nag-remit tayo ng overall savings na 3.4 billion noong 2021. Eh para po sa amin na nagkakandara pa mapondohan ang mga priority projects natin, masakit pong tignan na nagbalik tayo dahil hindi natin nagamit.
But DBWH Secretary Manny Bonoan explains the agency side, saying there were many sources of funds, including savings.
The savings is in standby budgetary allocation for augmentation of other projects, Madam Chair. So these are being used actually to augment what is the additional requirements for the deficiencies for ongoing projects. We have utilized this actually to augment our requirements for maintenance, for foreign assisted projects, and for preliminary engineering requirements. I think yung unappropriated or unallocated, unreleased funds, Mr. Chairman. These are probably some of the projects that are awaiting yung the releases for the SARO, because these are the projects that have been labeled as for later release.
A former human rights commissioner alarmed over yet another proposed budget cut for the agency. Under the Budget Department's 2023 spending bill, the Commission on Human Rights would only get 878 million pesos for next year. That's 8% lower than the CHR's 900 million peso budget for this year and way below the agency's proposed 1.6 billion peso spending plan. Former CHR Commissioner Gwen Pimentel Gana warns a budget cut would gravely affect services of the agency.
Ang epekto yung sa delivery of the services ng CHR. Kasi syempre, sabi ni ED Jackie, maapektuhan daw ang transportation. Eh anong equivalent doon? Syempre yung investigative arm namin. Even yung promotions, you know. So maraming mga services na maapektuhan. At napakalungkot isipin na bakit ba nila pinagdidiinan, nabawasan ang budget ng CHR. Eh, di ba nila nakikita na para sa proteksyon ng lahat. Mm-hmm. Kasi kahit sila, mambabatas, you know, covered sila.
Another former commissioner, meanwhile, says the government should immediately appoint new CHR officials. The CHR was left without a chairperson and commissioners since May this year.
There's a global standard for national human rights institutions accreditation. Mm-mm. Ngayon, just to say, now we're up for accreditation already in March 2023. Pagka natenga pa ang appointments, ay malaking dagok po yan sa komisyon. Kasi pag tiningnan mo, trabaho rin ang gobyerno natin to enable check and balance mechanisms in our country. Pag hindi yan ginawa, anong ibig sabihin yan about your governance, di ba? Na akala ko ba, bukas ka sa kritisismo, bukas ka na pakinggan ang mga hinaing ng tao.
The Defense Department submits a more than 200 billion peso budget proposal to Congress for its modernization and pension programs next year. Lawmakers, meanwhile, asked the defense chief about the push to revive mandatory military training in schools. More from Bianca Dava.
The Department of National Defense and Department of Education continue to conduct talks on a more comprehensive Reserve Officers Training Corps, or ROTC, program for senior high school students. The revival of the mandatory ROTC was among the issues tackled during deliberations on the DND's proposed 2023 budget at the House of Representatives on Thursday.
The DND, through the Armed Forces of the Philippines, as the implementer,
And of course, with the help of other agencies like the Department of Education and other agencies, we'll ensure that safeguards and strict accountability measures will be in place to prevent, as I was mentioning earlier, the repeat of unfortunate circumstances that happened before kung bakit na-abolish ang ROTC.
But the DND said the program will be different from its previous version. Several areas will be covered by the program, including illegal drug use prevention awareness, health and sanitation, road safety and discipline, and military history.
Hindi po ito yung typical na marcha-marcha po agad o masyao tinatawag nating military-centric. Ang purpose po nitong pinresent namin na program of instruction para po sa 11 grade 12, 11 and 12 ay ito po is yung i-develop po natin yung citizenship ng tao at isa lang po doon yung disaster resilience.
Hindi ko maintindihan na bakit pati yun, health and fitness, no, through the ROTC program, and nandiyan naman na yung ating mga PE teachers, yung ating mga health teachers para magturo niyan. So ano ba yung kakaiba, ano yung pwedeng maituro na hindi pwede ituro ng iba nating mga guro? Pagtuturo ng military history, actually pwede itong ma-integrate sa pagtuturo natin ng kasaysayan. For me, walang bagong ino-offer, no? Kaya tingin ko, iba yung tunay nating motibo dun sa panunumbalik ng mandatory ROTC.
Under the 2023 National Expenditure Program, the Defense Department will receive a budget of 310.87 billion pesos. 77% or 240.3 billion pesos will be the department's regular fund, which is 9% higher than the allocated budget for 2022, while the remaining 23% or 70.5 billion pesos will be allotted for the pension of retirees and veterans. Also under the DND's budget, 40 billion pesos will go to the AFP's revised modernization program.
The 40 billion is part of our multi-year contract allocation. We entered into contracts the previous years, and ito pong 40 billion ay part na ng babayaran natin dito sa mga multi-year contract allocations natin na ginawa noong mga nakaraang taon.
The AFP's modernization program aims to strengthen the military's capabilities in maritime security and counterterrorism, as well as in disaster response and humanitarian assistance. DND Officer in Charge Jose Faustino Jr. said the Philippines maintains its goal of developing a minimum credible defense posture despite an ongoing review of the AFP's modernization projects. At present, only 14% of the program's Horizon 2, which ends this year, has been completed.
I directed the Armed Forces of the Philippines to come up with a reprioritized Horizon 3 that will really address and at least achieve this minimum credible defense process. As I mentioned, detect, identify, intercept, and neutralize.
Bianca Dava, ABS-CBN News.
It's all systems go for the Maguindanao plebiscite this Saturday. The Commission on Elections says backup measures are in place to ensure smooth conduct of the referendum. The poll body expects at least a 60% voter turnout.
All the plebiscite committee members had duly reported and had been trained. We also have contingency plebiscite committee members, and these are personnel of the Philippine National Police, which the COMELEC had also trained. All the security preparations had been laid down, and the AFP and the PNP, our security partners, are very optimistic that there will be no untoward incident, but in case there are, we are also prepared for that. We asked our security partners to ensure not just the polling places, but the residences of our people in Maguindanao so that they will be able to go out of their homes, vote.
Residents all over the province will cast their vote Saturday, September 17, on whether they are in favor of splitting the region into two. The COMELEC is optimistic it can announce the results before Sunday.
For an advocacy rights group, it's high time to split Maguindanao into two. Ako Bakwit Chairperson Samira Gutok says Doing so would be beneficial for the province in terms of localization of services. If the split takes place, Kutok says, there has to be enough congressional representation to ensure equal development.
A strong representation from Maguindanao, napakarami nila pong tribo na irerepresenta sa Kongreso, ay isang mekanismo, kaya nga po demokrasya tayo. And at the same time, bilang Muslim representatives of a very rejuvenated Bangsamoro, now we know that President is knowledgeable about martial law na na-damage yung aming homeland. 5% of Mindanao is Maguindanao. Can you imagine na napakalaking 20 so-called billion ang nagastos annually since 1970s for conflict? And 56 countries of the Islamic world are monitoring us in the peace process.
The Labor Department will now supervise a Technical Education and Skills Development Authority, or TESDA. That's according to an executive order signed by President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. Based on that order, Labor Chief Bienvenido Leguesma will sit as chairperson of the TESDA board. TESDA was previously supervised by the Trade Department.
Hundreds of Filipino workers stranded on a remote American military base on Diego Garcia for at least 3 years. According to Philippine Migrant Workers Secretary Susan Ople, at least 800 Filipino employees of the U.S. Navy's defense contractor KBR have not left the island for 3 years over a dispute on their wages. The dispute began after the Philippine government called out the firm for paying below the minimum wage of $7 per hour. KBR employees are being paid only $5.25.
Natatakot sila pag nagbakasyon sila ng Pilipinas, ay to hindi na sila makabalik dahil hindi papayagan ng POEA dito, or pakatanggalin sila sa trabaho kasi may threat yung KBR, yung Kellogg Brown and Root na isang defense contractor ng US Navy. Binabantaan yung ibang manggagawa natin doon na mag-resign na lang kayo kung magbabakasyon kayo. Ang balak namin, kakausapin namin uli yung KBR, and kung wala pang mangyari, susulat na yung Department of Migrant Workers sa Department of Labor ng U.S. government para mag-intervene na sila dito sa problema na ito. At susulat din kami sa U.S. Navy kung saan may kakontrata itong KBR.
Employees on Diego Garcia, which sits in the Indian Ocean, can only leave through quarterly chartered flights. Their employer suspended the flights earlier this year, citing COVID concerns.
Philippine Finance Secretary Benjamin Diokno in favor of discontinuing offshore gaming operations in the country. In a Senate hearing, Senator Amy Marcos brought up the issue about POGOs, which have been involved in alleged cases of kidnappings. For Diokno, the social costs of the industry outweigh revenues that it generates.
Let's discontinue with the POGO because of the social cost of the POGO. In fact, the total revenue for 2021 is down to 3.9 billion. That po, at peak, it was 7.2 billion in 2020. Okay. So if you have to ask me, I'm in favor of discontinuing. In fact, China has discontinued.
Well, China declared
even,
it illegal.
Even Cambodia has. And it also has a reputational risk because people will ask, why are they going to the Philippines? But then it's continuing to China, then it's continuing to come. Why are they going to the Philippines? Maybe because we are loose or we're not strict on our rules, right? So meron tayong reputational risk.
Details about the state funeral for Queen Elizabeth II have been announced. The state funeral will be held at Westminster Abbey Monday, beginning at 11 a.m. London time. Over 2,000 guests, including world leaders, are expected to attend the event. U.S. President Joe Biden and French President Emmanuel Macron are among those who have confirmed attendance. After the service, the Queen's coffin will be transferred by the Royal Hearse to Windsor Castle before a committal service at St. George's Chapel. The Queen will be buried in the King George VI Memorial Chapel alongside her husband Philip, Prince Philip, who died last year. Meanwhile, the queue time towards the Westminster Hall, where the Queen is lying in state, is now up to 11 hours as thousands of mourners continue to arrive to pay their last respects.
Yeah, I think everybody has their own different personal reasons for coming. Obviously, all of us want to pay respect to the Queen.
We come from Gloucester, in Gloucestershire, and we've been 6 hours in the queue. We just felt we needed to be here.
Meanwhile, Moscow blasts London's decision not to invite Russian President Vladimir Putin to the Queen's funeral. Russia's foreign ministry says the UK's attempt to use a national tragedy for geopolitical purposes is blasphemous towards the Queen's memory. Britain has sent out invitations to heads of state of nearly every country in the world, except for Russia, Belarus, Syria, Venezuela, Afghanistan, and Myanmar. Up next, the Philippine Senate Blue Ribbon Committee offers protection to a witness in the Education Department's controversial laptop project.
And the World Bank sees a rising risk of global recession next year. More news when we return.
Pesos, while local galunggong is at 240 pesos. White onions remain unavailable in most markets in Metro Manila. Red onion is at 140 pesos per kilo. Imported garlic is at 120 pesos per kilo, while siling labuyo is at 250 pesos per kilo. Refined sugar is at 95 pesos per kilo. Washed sugar is at 75, while brown sugar is at 70 pesos. Price of vegetables also remains stable too. Tomatoes are at 70 pesos per kilo, carrots at 140 pesos, while eggplant is at 80 pesos per kilo. Ron.
Jervis Manan with that story. Thanks, Jervis.
Operations at Coca-Cola Philippines' bottling plants in Tagbiliran City, Bohol and Pavia, Iloilo suspended Friday. The beverage company says it has suspended bottling operations due to the lack of supply of bottler's-grade sugar, which is a key ingredient in making soda and other sweetened beverages. It adds it is doing everything it can to minimize supply disruptions. The company is also in talks with the government and other stakeholders to come up with a sustainable solution to the issue.
The report of the majority bloc in the Senate Blue Ribbon Committee prevails over the minority's findings on the sugar importation fiasco. That's according to committee chairman Francis Tolentino. He says while he respects the report of Senators Cojo Pimentel and Riz Ontiveros, he only considers it to be supplemental.
If we dissect the views, they now claim that the persons indicted should be forgiven because there would be no basis, etc. But then again, the evidence presented and called from the several hearings would point to the majority's opinion as based on evidence, based in fact adduced, based in law.
Tolentino also responded to the minority bloc's claim that the panel's report lacked evidence.
They should have asked questions. They should have supplied us with the evidence. Those are mere allegations. They participated in the hearings. They were there. They should have supplied us with the proof to enable us to reach that quantum of proof, that certainty that these persons are liable. This should be done. So they were allowed to submit. They have the burden to supply us with the evidence required. Mm. But we waited. Wala naman. Mere allegations cannot stand.
A group of teachers dismayed about the latest revelations from the Senate's probe on the Education Department's controversial laptop purchase. On Thursday, DepEd's procurement director claimed the bidding for the allegedly overpriced laptops was done even before a memorandum of agreement was signed and notarized. But the former head of the Budget Department's procurement arm refuted this. The Teachers Dignity Coalition believes there are indeed irregularities in the 2.4 billion peso deal, since officials are now pointing fingers at each other.
Hingi ng budget yung mga ahensya, and yet hindi naman na-utilize, no, para doon, ano, sa purpose itong budget na to. Aba, eh, malaki naman pong malaking problema po yan. Malaking issue po yan, ano, kasi pera ng bayan nito, eh, no, itong ginagamit. And ang masakit pa nito, no, pera ng bayan yung ginagamit na supposedly para tumugon, ano, doon sa mga problema.
Meanwhile, the Alliance of Concerned Teachers hopes someone will be held accountable for the questionable deal at the end of the Senate's investigation. That's as the teachers who were supposed to be the recipients of the laptops continue to struggle with the resumption of face-to-face classes.
Mag-iisang buwan na lang po ay magpo-full-blown face-to-face na sa November 2, eh. Eh, pero ang ginagawa ng DepEd ay wala yatang nagagawa rito para ipagplanuhan ito.
The Senate Blue Ribbon Committee offers protection to an education official who shed light on the laptop controversy. Senator Francis Tolentino says they're just waiting for an update from Attorney Marcelo Bragado Jr., the DepEd's Procurement Management Service Director. But he asserts the committee is not yet ready to clear anyone's name.
We have to really connect the dots based on facts, evidence. There is such a thing as a quantum of proof required, and we're still tying this up all together. All the loose thing. We are looking into this because you look at rights of people, you look at the amount involved, and you look at the consequences relative to the educational system.
Progressive lawmakers not satisfied with the explanation of Vice President Sara Duterte on why the Education Department needs 150 million pesos in confidential funds. Duterte earlier told Congress this budget will be used to address cases of sexual grooming of students and the alleged recruitment of terrorist organizations in schools. But Kabataan Party List Representative Raul Manuel isn't convinced.
Nandiyan na yung mga programa dapat, no? Paano i-address yung ganung mga bagay. For example, yung tungkol sa grooming ng ating mga students, ating mga kabataan. We have the Child Protection Program na pending din yung kanyang budget cut. Hindi na bago yung ganung mga issues at dapat nga meron ng clear-cut guidelines. Paano talaga ma-hold accountable yung mga perpetrators noon? Doon naman sa matters of national security, hindi yun part ng mandate ng Department of Education. Actually, dapat nga yung focus niya ay paano natin matutulungan yung ating mga kabataan to recover from learning loss.
Manuel also says lawmakers missed the opportunity to question Duterte directly about the office of the Vice President's proposed budget for 2023. That's after the leadership of the House Committee on Appropriations swiftly terminated Wednesday's deliberations out of courtesy.
Sa committee deliberations, ang haharap talaga doon ay yung mga opisyal ng ahensya. Ibig sabihin, kung sino yung secretary, yung head ng department, pati nga yung mga undersecretary, required pa nga na pati mga regional directors ay umupo para tiyak na kung ano man yung tanong naming mga kongresista ay merong sasagot. Pero pagdating na sa plenary deliberations, ang mas magsasalita na in behalf of the agency ay yung mga kongresista who committed to sponsor the proposed budget of these agencies.
The Philippine Public Works Department plans to undertake a massive rehabilitation of roads in Metro Manila. Public Works Chief Manny Bonoan says the rehabilitation program will include preventive maintenance overlays and provision of specific lanes for motorcycles and riders. The secretary said the plan specially targets major thoroughfares. It will also be discussed with the Metropolitan Manila Development Authority.
Drunk driving and drug use emerge as the top causes of most road crashes in Metro Manila so far this year. The Land Transportation Office says 385 out of 407 drivers involved in the incidents were positive for alcohol or substance use. The agency adds the spike in road crashes in Metro Manila has already killed 16 individuals.
Merong interagency ang LTO, kabahagi po natin ang Highway Patrol Group dito, ang Philippine National Police, ang PIDEA. Meron din po programa yung tinatawag nating Harabas. At ang idea po dito is masawata po natin yung mga, lalo na doon sa mga public utility drivers na gumagamit po ng droga o langos sa alak tuwing sila po'y namamasada.
An update on the weather now. Typhoon Nanmadol continues to intensify before making its way into the Philippines. It was last spotted 1,465 kilometers east-northeast of extreme northern Luzon, with maximum sustained winds of 165 kilometers per hour and gusts of up to 205 kilometers per hour. Once inside the country, it will be named Josie, but it is also seen to exit by Friday night. While it will not directly affect the country, it has been enhancing the southwest monsoon since Wednesday. State Weather Bureau Pagasa says Nanmadol will reach super typhoon category over the next 24 hours while heading towards Ryukyu Islands.
The threat of a global recession is growing. That's according to the latest World Bank study as major central banks hike rates to fight inflation. The World Bank says the global economy is in the middle of one of the most internationally synchronous episodes of monetary and fiscal policy tightening of the past five decades. It notes their compounding effects may have larger impacts than intended, both in tightening financial conditions and steepening the growth slowdown by next year. World Bank President David Malpass now urges policymakers to shift their focus from reducing consumption to boosting production. Inflation worldwide has been rising due to supply constraints, which were worsened by the Russian invasion of Ukraine and COVID lockdowns in China.
The Philippine Stock Exchange Index ends a trading week in the red, tracking the movement of regional markets. Meanwhile, the peso weakens to a new all-time low against the U.S. dollar. Michelle Ong reports.
Asian stocks extend their weekly declines into a fifth straight week, following more weakness in U.S. markets and a surge in short-term Treasury yields. All eyes will be on the Federal Reserve, which meets next week after persistently high global inflation numbers. Trading edges Ron Nakoba says a hefty 75 basis point rate hike from the Fed is all but certain now, and that will force the Philippine Central Bank to at least match it if the BSP is to cushion the local currency. Both central banks meet next week. The Philippine peso on Friday tumbled to a new all-time low against the U.S. dollar, closing at 57.43 after hitting 57.44 intraday. Acoba also says until inflation shows a consistent downtrend, expect stocks trading to stay choppy.
We're out of this downtrend as shown in the chart, but we haven't really actually based. So in the next 6 weeks, 6 to 8 weeks, in the next 8 months, which is in line with the schedule of data releases and the market what the market will wait for and expect, which is, like I said, the release of the next inflation data and the decision of the next monetary policies. The index will just remain choppy, perhaps trading between 6.4 and 6.6 in the next 6 weeks. Mm-hmm. And the only cue that the market can see as positive is that when they finally see that inflation has indeed cooled down and that the Fed finally signals that, okay, we have raised our rates so much and that it's now time to slow our raises. That's the only time that we would finally get some momentum higher. Until then, we will see some choppy movements.
For the day, the PSE index fell by nearly 0.5% to 65.48, also notching its fourth weekly loss. Although foreign funds turned net buyers again by a quarter of a billion, this is the fifth net foreign buying session in six. Sun Life Investments' Mike Enriquez notes how, fundamentally speaking, local corporations are stronger now.
Clearly, companies have already been recovering in terms of their financials. As what we've seen over the first half results, I think fundamentals continue to be strong. However, it's the negative sentiment towards how the U.S. is adjusting rates to fight inflation that's really curbing this negative sentiment and weighing down equity markets.
In corporate stories, gaming play Leisure and Resorts World rebrands into DigiPlus Corporation to better align with the company's new focus on innovative technological platforms. Also approved by the board, an increase in its authorized capital stock to 7 billion pesos from 5. Leisure and Resorts World operates bingo parlors across the country. Meanwhile, Injep CS Merrymart launches its new grocery wholesale app, allowing consumers to buy in bulk while enjoying discounted rates. This is part of the group's initiative to reach more consumers. Last June, Merrymart announced signing a 15-year long-term lease contract with Ayala Land to build standalone full-size supermarkets in Nuvali, Laguna and Crescendo, Tarlac. Michelle Long, ABS-CBN News.
Solar panels floating on water light up a fishing community in Laguna Lake. As Alvin El Chico tells us, the proponents of the project plan to cover more portions of the lake by 2024 to augment the Philippines' power supply.
We often see solar panels in mountains or rooftops, but in San Antonio, Baie, Laguna, the panels are floating in the lake. This is the pilot project of SunAsia Energy to prove that floating solar islands are feasible in producing considerable amount of energy and helping the local community.
During the operations and maintenance, these people are also fisher folks. We hired them to operate and maintain this project. And that's what we are going to do when we construct the 1,300 megawatt project.
The floating panel is connected to the village hall, providing a huge part of its electricity need.
Ang natitipid po namin kada buwan ay umaabot halos ng 13,000 pesos. Opo. At nung buhat po ng itayo yan, ng 2019, ay halos nakakatipid na kami ng almost 400,000 sa loob ng 3 taon.
SunAsia Energy, together with Blue Leaf Energy of Singapore, intend to build more than 40,000 floating solar islands in a 1,000-hectare area within Laguna Lake, which is more than 90,000 hectares big. The $1.2 billion project aims to generate 1,300 megawatts of electricity by 2024. Fisher folks were already consulted and assured their daily fishing activity will not be hampered.
May bibigay po silang navigation na daanan po ng mga mangisda. At isa pong concern na hiningi po namin sa kanila ay yung kasiguraduhan ng aming mga mangisda. Kung siya ay maitatayo, meron pong pangitlugan sa ilalim po niya ng mga pangisdaan. Dadami po ang isda po sa lawan.
The financing of the solar on water project in Laguna Lake is one of the commitments obtained by President Marcos during his Singapore visit.
The 1,300 megawatt will be the largest in Southeast Asia. This will be the largest solar on water installation. It will attract not only investors, but also tourists and researchers. And maybe we can improve it more sa other bodies of water.
SunAsia Energy hopes the project will be finished earlier than 2024 so that it can augment the country's electricity supply.
Pag lumaki yung supply natin, magkakaroon tayo ng mas sapat na supply at mababawasan natin yung mga tinatawag nating rotational brownout. And mas mapapababa natin ang kuryente gamit ang renewable dahil ngayon masyado nang nagmamahal ang presyo ng ating coal at mga diesel.
The company says this project is another proof that there is a big potential for developing more renewable energy in the country's energy mix. Alvin El Chico, ABS-CBN News, Baé, Laguna.
Nobel Peace Prize laureate Maria Ressa takes her fight against disinformation to Canada, where she urges fellow journalists to continue exposing falsehoods. Rowena Papasin reports.
A standing ovation greeted 2021 Nobel Peace Prize winner and journalist Maria Ressa at the packed Faye and Milton Wong Experimental Theatre in Vancouver. In the discussion hosted by veteran Canadian journalist Carol Off, Ressa warned that by 2024, many countries will be taken over by dictators if the spread of lies and fake news through various social media platforms is not stopped. Ressa said tech platforms should be held accountable for allowing this, but added that governments should also enact laws to stop the spread of lies.
I'm looking forward to legislation that the EU is doing, the Digital Services Act, the Digital Markets Act, that will prevent the spread of lies, right? That in the end, you can't have a fact-based news piece run up against a very salacious lie laced with anger and hate. The lie will always win.
Ressa, whose online news site Rappler released a series of reports that exposed social media troll farms, said journalists also have a responsibility to continue exposing these falsehoods to get back the public's trust.
You know, we've borne a lot of the brunt of the attacks, right? Because in order to change the narrative, you get rid of the facts. So it's been harder for us. So I think the first is hold the line. We just got to keep doing what we're doing, even if it's harder and harder to do. That's the first. And then I think the second thing is we need to collaborate.
CBC journalist Carol Off, who hosted the program, said she is alarmed at what Ressa has revealed in her forthcoming book, How to Stand Up to a Dictator.
She documents it very well, what the threat is from the social media tech companies, how they're manipulating information, how they're exploiting propaganda to make profit, and how dangerous that is.
Meanwhile, University of British Columbia professor Leonora Angeles said Ressa has made her proud to be a Filipino. She agreed with Ressa's observation that the world is under siege and faces real danger if nothing is done to uphold facts.
We are in great trouble if we don't have that shared reality based on truth, based on facts. And if we don't have that shared reality, how can we even frame the problems that we are facing now properly?
Ressa has been hailed internationally for continuing her investigative work despite the threats and charges filed against her by the Duterte administration. Award-winning radio journalist Andrea Croson, who has worked for the BBC and CBC, said Ressa is an inspiration to journalists everywhere.
I think for people who are journalists my age, but also for the next generation of journalists coming up, I think it's so powerful for people to see role models like her.
The baton was passed me at a very bad time. But I'm not going to drop it.
With Ressa saying she's passing the baton to the younger generation, journalism student Carla Jubaili said she now feels a bigger responsibility to get the truth out.
A lot of journalism nowadays is under attack in the Philippines, in Canada, but in the Philippines especially. And so as my mom is Filipino, I feel a lot of responsibility to the community to, you know, to get stories out there with truth.
The Simon Fraser University also conferred on Ressa an honorary Doctor of Laws degree in June this year. Rowena Papasin, ABS-CBN News, Vancouver.
Another tennis great bids goodbye to the sport. Roger Federer has announced he will be retiring after next week's Laver Cup. In his message to the fans, the Swiss maestro admitted his knee problems have forced him to end his career. Federer has been out of action since a quarterfinal loss at Wimbledon in 2021, after which he underwent his third knee surgery in 18 months. He has 20 Grand Slam titles under his belt.
As many of you know, the past 3 years have presented me with challenges in the form of injuries and surgeries. I've worked hard to return to full competitive form, but I also know my body's capacities and limits, and its message to me lately has been clear. I am 41 years old. I've played more than 1,500 matches over 24 years. Tennis has treated me more generously than I ever would have dreamt, and now I must recognize when it is time to end my competitive career. The Laver Cup next week in London will be my final ATP event.
Rafael Nadal, arguably Federer's greatest on-court rival, says their shared years together was an honor and a privilege. He says Federer's retirement marks a sad day for himself and for sports around the world. Federer's retirement comes just weeks after fellow tennis legend Serena Williams also played her final professional match at the U.S. Open. A new movie about Marilyn Monroe is just one of the latest releases at the box office. Manny, the movie guy, has that story.
Our ancestors push us!
All hail Viola Davis as our woman king.
Who enslave us?
The Oscar-winning actress is front and center as Naniska, the ferocious general of an all-female unit of warriors who protected the West African kingdom of Dahomey in the 1800s. This is an effective historical action drama where equal attention is given to the spectacular action scenes and the emotional dramatic moments. Dynamic performances, kinetic directing, and lush cinematography give The Woman King 3.5 out of 4 heart-pounding kisses. Also in theaters, Clerks 3.
That's how we did it in the 90s, son!
The Clerks gang is back for the third time in this funny and heartfelt outing.
What's the movie gonna be about?
It's about him working here.
In this very meta, Part 3, Jeff Anderson's Randall decides to make a movie about life at the Quick Stop convenience store after suffering a massive heart attack.
Wish I had a life worth saving.
Directed by franchise creator Kevin Smith, this self-indulgent but fun nostalgic ride to the Clerks era is a must-see for fans. And for that, Clerks 3 gets 3 out of 4. It delivers kisses. 4 out of 4, Norma Jean Mortensen kisses. I'm Manny the Movie Guy for ABS-CBN News.
And those were the top stories today. I'm Denise Tinsay.
And I'm Ron Cruz. You can watch exclusive content and highlights and recaps of our shows online. Thank you for watching.